share the testimony. I've got a lot of them. I can't think of all of them right now, but the main one right now is I accidentally broke my glasses the other day, the ones I'm wearing. They're broke on this side, but anyway, I went to have them fixed, and she said, well, they're broke. You can't fix them. She said, you can glue it, and it'll stay a little while, but it won't last long. And she looked around. She said, don't tell anybody here, but she said, go to eBay. She said, you'll have to have new frames. And you know how expensive they are. And so she looked everything up and everything. She came back and said, go to eBay.com. And I said, oh, I've never went on there. And she said, well, I'll write it all down. She wrote all the numbers down on my glasses. And she said, you go there and you can get them a lot cheaper. So she brought it up to show me. And so I paid $28 for new frames. They aren't here yet, but they're on the way. And then they'll put them in for nothing. So that saved me a lot of money. But he's been so good to me about my son. I know have all of you pray, and I still like you to pray. They think he does not have cancer, but he's got to wait 90 days to heal up. They sent him to Indianapolis finally, and I'm so glad of that. After 90 days, they're going to do a MRI, and she said then they'll know for sure exactly what's going on, and then they'll set a time, and they're going to go in again and take everything out that needs to come out. They don't think it's cancer. They can't tell. They took another biopsy, and they still can't tell. So they're going to open him up, do that, and hopefully take it all out and take the hook up his colon again so he can get rid of the colostomy bag. So just keep praying for him. He needs lots of prayers. He did go to church last week and said he was going this week with some friends, and they're really working on him, so he's trying. He quit smoking, and I think he quit drinking, too. So that alone's great. Anybody else? Okay. I didn't want to say that, but... Yes, amen. Yes. Anybody else? Thank you. God is so good. Yes. Let's just keep it up that I won't have to teach, because everything you've mentioned is what I've got to mention. Anybody else got something? Now, God doesn't make mistakes, and he had not told me. No football. That's like Matt said one day, "Well, Mom, you don't want to come over to our house anymore?" And I said, "All you do is sit and watch TV." Said football, and I'll watch football and come home and watch TV on my own, and I won't be watching football. So, God knows. Terry, you got it? Well, Praise the Lord, yes. Anybody else? Amen. Amen. Yes. Did I see a hand back here? Can you have one more? Yeah, you can have one more. Praise the Lord. Okay. God's been working this week, hasn't he? I'm telling you, he's corrected me a couple times this week. I told Patty, I begged him and begged him, you know, don't do that. Help me do that. Help me do this. Well, you guys all help me because now we can all be dismissed. We're going to talk about in James. You want to stand and we'll pray. Yeah, somebody got it. You got. All right. Let's just keep remembering here. I want to tell you, Teresa, I just thank God seeing you here. I know it takes a lot of energy. And I've been praying that God would give you more strength, and I just thank him because I see you home. And you know, we just need to testify about what God does. I was thinking today as I came in that there was a message that came by through one Sunday, and he said, "You ask for the impossible, but you do not believe." How do we get things done if we don't believe? How can he minister if we don't believe? And I said, "Lord, what's wrong with me? What's the matter with me?" So I think, you know, a few weeks I had a lesson said, "Who am I?" We all need to realize who we are and step up to the plate like you, who wants to have the opportunity to witness. And everything that y'all testified is going to be in James. That's why I say I don't even have to teach, because we've all studied James. We all know what he says. It's talked about faith. It's preached about faith. It's taught. Yet every time there's a message, he said,
Why don't you cast your cares upon me? Why don't you do this? Or haven't I not told you this? You know, I think these show you that God is working. And we all just need to step up and just say, here we are, God, use me. And I just thank God for it. I'm telling you, God is going to do something. But we have to move. Father God, we do thank you for this time. We do thank you for all of these testimonies of how you've met needs and how you've fixed cars and how you've introduced people. I just thank you, Lord, that for as we stand here, that everyone here you can use. There's a song, Lord, that says, if you can use anybody, you can use me. And I'm asking you, Lord, that you use me. I ask you that you use all of us, that we would be an example of what you can do, that we would be, our lives would show others, just not even have to witness, but just do what you are telling us to do. I ask, Lord, for these ones who are sick. And I thank you, Lord, for Teresa. And I thank you for giving her strength. And I just pray for the ones who are not here, who are sick, who are weak, and who needs to be encouraged, Lord. I pray that you would just go to them right now, Lord, and let the Holy Spirit just strengthen them up and cause their spirit to be alive and encouraged. And I just praise you for each and one here. I ask, Lord, that you would just minister for this lesson that I have. And, Lord, I'm not going to tell them anything new, but the Holy Spirit can quicken theirs. And that you can tell them what you would have them to do, what I would do, Lord. I just praise you and thank you for all that you do. I ask that you would just have your way in this lesson today, Lord. Even though it's going to be repeated, I pray, God, that you would just bless it. I thank you for each one of these testimonies, Lord, and I ask that you would just help us to be stronger, and Lord, help our faith to grow, and Lord, as we see you do things, Lord, that we would be able just to accept who we are in you. I thank you, Lord, for all of these things, and I ask that you would just have your way, for I ask these things in your name, and everyone said, amen. Now, we are going to talk in James. I'm going to tell you, I had a struggle with this because, like I said, everybody talks about faith. Everybody teaches about faith. Everybody preaches about faith. But in James chapter 1, verse 12, this is what we're going to use a little bit. It says, blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord hath promised to those that love him. And I believe that we've been talking about the different crosses or the different crowns. And because it's the crown of life, it is so simple, yet it's so hard to teach, because everybody knows about the life in Jesus. The paraphrase says this. It says, happy is the person who remains faithful. I thought of this, Terry, when you said you get so aggravated and you get so frustrated when things happen and you not get to do what you want to do. That's the way we are. That's the way we are. We get so upset, even though we know God can do anything. Our faith is tested. How many's got faith? We all got faith. Every day in our life, we are tested. Every day. About something, some reason, somebody. Every day. And it says, remains faithful and under trials when he passed the test. How many has failed the test? Course, I know you guys don't. No, these are rhetorical questions because I know you guys don't do that. So I have to raise both my hands and raise my feet and everything else because I don't pass the test a lot. I'm not a good test taker. That he will pass that, he that passed the test, he will receive the life that God has promised. Now we all know that Christ is coming back. We all know that. We all know that, and it says blessed. What we know about James, I did a little bit of studying on James, and in the book of James, it just talks about life and how we should express our faith in our daily life. And I'm sure we all do that one way or another. At work, doing shopping, whatever. But James is saying, listen, this is what you have to do. You have to put up with things. Even this morning, Terry came in, and I said something to Shannon. I forgot what I said, but it wasn't pretty nice, probably, about Terry. But she knows I'm kidding, so does he. And you know what she said? She said, I tolerate him. Look in the scripture. It says, they that endure. What does endure mean? It means to tolerate. So if we have problems, we need to endure them. We have to tolerate them. And as I was reading this, I said, Lord, I know. Some people just tolerate me. But that's all right, because I just tolerate other people. I put up with them. But they're talking about the faith. You need to stand up for what you believe. You have to stand up for what you believe. And it says, blessed. In chapter 5 of Matthew, if you want to turn there, you all know what it is? Chapter 5, Sermon on the Mountain. And Jesus is talking about this. And what I have learned about James is that it said, and I'm just telling you what I read because I have not really did a full study on him. It said that they thought that James got saved after Jesus had died. And Paul writes in Galatians, he says that James is the apostle. And apparently James didn't think it. He was an apostle, but he was because he was a pastor. And then it says, writing the book of James, it says, James, the Lord's brother. And I thought, was he his brother? You know, he will be our brother, our mother. He'll be whatever we need for us. But the point was with James is that he learned to believe and trust in God. And then he's teaching people here, and it's really the Jews that has came to the Lord, and he's teaching them this. He says, you have to live this life. You have to live it. It says that you have the crown of life, but he just doesn't give these crown of lives just to anybody. You say, well, he does. No, he doesn't. He gives them to the people that love him, that live for him. Who's got Matthew 5, verse 1? 5, 1, read it. Okay, verse 2. Verse 3. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit, what? Heaven. They will go to heaven. The poor in spirit are sinners. Yet the point. Do you know what Beatitudes mean? We talk about the Beatitudes all the time. Do you know what they mean? Happy. Blessed means happy. Beatitudes, and I know this because I looked it up. It means a perfect blessing. What is a perfect blessing to the poor in spirit? The kingdom of heaven. Why did he send Jesus to die on the cross? To get us reconnected with God. Why? So we could inherit the crown of life. This has not been easy for me to teach. This has not really been easy for me at all. Because you all know all this. You all know it. It's what God wants us to do. We all know that we have to live right. We all know that. So he says, blessed are you. We should be happy through the trials and the tribulations that we go through. Right in James, verse 3 or 2, it says, my brethren, count it a joy. How many times have you heard people preach on that? How many times have we taught on that? Count it a joy. And we all say, I'm happy because I have to be tried because of different trials. And let me tell you this morning, I'm not going to go into all the details, but Patty and I had a good laugh at it. But let me tell you, this morning was not good for me. You've heard about Murphy's Law? What is Murphy's Law? Exactly. And I'm going to tell you, from the time my foot hit the floor, everything went so bad that I said, Lord, I'm just going to call and let somebody else take it. That is not enduring. That is complaining. But by the time I got here, we saw what was funny about it, and I feel fine. But we don't approach trials like that. How many likes to be tried? Do you know what tried means? Tried means to be proven. God says, prove me. Here it says, for when he is tried, when you have to prove yourself, you have to prove yourself every day, because God has allowed us, the poor in spirit, to be in a place where we can meet him. And faith is the biggest part of it. For without faith, it's what? It's impossible to please God. How many wants to please God? How many times our faith has been? All the time. All the time. It says, don't let your faith waver. How many does it waver? Well, let me tell you, when you don't get what you need today, you don't get it till a week, and it wavers. And James knew this. And he says, listen, blessed is the man that endureth. What's next verse? Verse 4. Who's got Matthew, verse 4? Okay. What do you think about that when it says, blessed are they that mourn shall be comforted? What pops into your mind right away? We're going to have a little quiz. What pops in your mind? What? Funeral? Okay. Anybody else? Real loud. Just whatever popped in your mind when you talk about mourn. Grief? Okay. Anybody else? Loss of a loved one? Yes? Okay. Concern for others? Yes. And that's what I thought. The blessed of the poor. You know, when I study this, it's that we mourn the ones that's not like us. That you say, us? Yeah, saved. We should mourn. We should care for the people who are not saved. We should mourn for them, because what's going to happen? They're going to die if we don't tell them, they're going to die if we do tell them. But they're going to die either with or without Lord. It's how we do it. We should mourn for these people. And as I was looking at this, I was like, Lord, you know, I pray for people who get saved. What happens when you mourn? You're sad. You're sad. You really feel the pain. Do we really feel the pain for the loss? Now, this is up to you. I don't want any answers. I want you to think about this. This is what it means. I thought about all these things that I would have to suffer. I thought about this personal. But when you look into it, he says, you know, they're not like you. You mourn for the ones that are not saved. How did you get saved? Somebody kept you in prayer. I was saved when I was 15. By 18, there I got smart and I went somewhere else. I had a good time. At 21, I found myself back in church. And when I was sitting in the back, Wilma gets up there and she gives a testimony. And you know what she says? She says, God answered my prayer today that I have been praying for 3 years that she would come back and find the Lord. You see, if we really want somebody to come see the Lord or visit or get saved, we will make a point to keep him in prayer. And I mean pray. Not just say, oh, Lord, save him, Lord, save him. I mean get down and mourn for them and weep for them and cause them to say, Lord, I want them to do something. We need to become concerned. Chris is all the time talking about the empty pews. Thursday night, you're supposed to pray for people to come in. Well, we need to pray for us to go out. And as I was reading this, I thought, Lord, this is just for me. This is just for me. Now, the verse that we always talk about in James is James verse 22. Everybody knows that. What does it say? Everybody knows it, even without reading it. Do you know what it says? It says, be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only. And I'm thinking, okay, Lord. You say, well, we do that. We pray, we visit, we pray, we do this, and we do that. Now, James says the true religion is James 27. As I was studying the background, that's the key verse of the whole book of James. Verse 27 in James chapter 1. It says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their afflictions and to keep himself unspotted from the world. When I read that, I thought, how many times do you go visit? How many times do you get concerned? True, but you know, when we have faith, we're going to work at that faith and we're going to go and we are going to pray and we're going to expect God to answer the prayer. When you go visit the sick, you pray that God will heal them. That's why I'm so glad for Teresa. I said, Lord, just give her the strength. Give her the strength. And she came a few Sundays and then something happened. And I said, Lord, the strength needs to stay. We need to keep our strength. We need to keep our faith working daily. And James is saying this. He said, you need to express it every day in your living, in your life. You know, we think that we have to give out the word, but we don't. We just have to live it. And that's what God is, that's what James is saying. He took this from the Lord. Verse 5, I think, in Matthew. What does that say? We've had 4 or 3. The next one, the meek. Anybody got that one? Blessed are the meek. I am anything but meek. How many is meek here? I'm not meek. I don't keep my mouth shut when it should be done. I'm not patient. I'm more than I was. I'm getting better. But I'm not. Meek's put up with people. They don't get mad. Let me tell you, there's a story in the Bible of a rich man and Lazarus. Y'all know this? And Lazarus was a beggar and he had nothing. And as I reread that, I didn't read anywhere where he complained. I didn't read anywhere where he blamed God. How many of us have said, why? Why am I going through this? What did I do to deserve this? Do we say that? Of course you don't. I do. Why me, Lord? And you know what the answer is? Why not? Why not? The meek put up, they tolerate, they endure. They don't strike back. Because they're an example of God. And I've told you this before. When my kids were little, they weren't little, they were outside playing basketball. And I had Paul, he was Casey's dad at the time, or he was Casey's dad, but he was little. And I had his sister, and his sister was just a baby. And I was busy, and they were being kids. They were rowdy and all this, you know, and I was complaining and yelling at them and complaining and yelling at them, and I was sweeping the kitchen, and I was sweeping and complaining and sweeping and complaining, and God said, I don't talk to you like that. And I went, no, you don't. Sometimes we forget what we need to be. Blessed, we need to be blessed. God has perfect blessings for each one of us. Is the man who endures, that we tolerate what comes our way without complaining. Lazarus did nothing. I don't read where he complained. I read where he ate the crumbs, where the dogs came and licked him, and he died. I don't read where he shook his hand at that rich man and said, you got everything and you don't give me anything. But I read that he went, when he died, to Abraham's bosom, where it says here, temptation for when he is tried, when you prove yourself, shall receive the crown of life. Now, he didn't go to heaven. He went to a waiting place. He didn't go to heaven because Christ had not died. He had not risen. But all these things have happened to us. So we need to read James, and we need to know what the pure religion is, and we need to mourn for the lost, and we need to be meek when they come in, and we need to put God as an example, and we need to live that way, and that's what James is saying. Either put up or shut up. If we can't live that way, then don't go around and talk about it. If you want to show the true you, the true you, you will do this thing. And I'm not saying this is me, and this is what God said. Verse 27. To visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted of the world. That means you need to be, you say, you know, God doesn't give the crown of life to everybody. It's available. It's available. But you have to do certain things. How many gets a check every Friday or every once a month or every 2 weeks for doing nothing? We're excluded. But if you go to a job, they don't just pay you. You have to be there. God hands out all of these blessings. They're there for our taking. But we have to work. We have to do it. He wants us to have these blessings. He wants us to church to grow. He wants people. But we got to start mourning for the loss. We need to start thinking, listen, why didn't I do it? Why don't I visit? Why don't I do this? Why don't I do this? Why don't I do this? Because we don't want to get out of our comfort zone. Me. Not you. Me. If every one of us would just invite one person that we want to see come to Christ, I can't see your hand. This church could be full. But we don't do what the Word says. We say we do. But why does He always say, I will do what I say. I will finish. You need to cast your cares upon me. You have to believe. You need to. Why do we get these? Because we don't do what we're supposed to do. Just live. Just live a life that's pleasing. Not to me, not to your neighbor, not to the pastor, but to God. And see if He will not only bless you, but He will cause this church to grow. That we cannot just sit in our comfort place and expect Him just to shell it out. Father, I thank You for Your Word. And Lord, if it's just for me, I accept it. And I'm just asking You to help me to be better. Be with us in our following service, Lord. Let the Holy Spirit just minister to each and every one of us. Help the Lord, help the Spirit to speak to each one of our hearts about this living for You the way that You want us, so that we can have the crown of life. And I ask these things in Your name, and everyone said, amen.
I love You, Lord, for Your mercy never fails.